सर, माय पेशेंट एक्स वाई जेड, 45-year-old मेल, रेजिडेंट ऑफ मीरठ उत्तर प्रदेश, मैनुअल लेबरर बाय ऑक्यूपेशन, बिलोंग्स टू द लोअर सोशियो इकोनॉमिक स्टेटस अकॉर्डिंग टू द मॉडिफाइड कुप्रोसोमी स्केल, प्रेजेंटेड टू आवर इमरजेंसी ऑन 26 February विद चीफ कंप्लेंट्स ऑफ फीवर सिंस 1 month, कफ सिंस 1 month, चेस्ट पेन सिंस 1 month एंड शॉर्टनेस ऑफ ब्रेथ सिंस 15 days. History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently well 1 month back when he developed fever, which was insidious in onset, low grade, not associated with chills and rigor. Patient noticed fever more during the evening time. However, patient was able to do his routine activities. Fever used to relieve on taking medications. Patient also gives the history of cough since 1 month, which was insidious in onset, not associated with any expectoration or chest pain. Patient says cough used to get relieved on taking cough syrup. There was no diurnal or positional variation of the cough, which he was noticed. There was no history of any increase in the cough after exposure to the smoke, dust, or cold. There was no history suggestive of blood after coughing. There is a history of chest pain since 30 days, which was insidious in onset and gradually progressive in intensity. Diffuse, dull, aching kind of pain over the right side of the chest wall, more in the lower side of the right axilla. It aggravates on lying to the right side and used to relieve on lying to the right side. Also, there is an aggravation of pain. Patient was noticed with the deep inspiration initially. However, subsequently, it was not associated with any respiration. Intensity of the pain reduces on taking medication. Patient also gives the history of shortness of breath since 15 days, which was insidious in onset and gradually progressive. Patient noticed shortness of breath initially when he was going to the shop, which was 2 kilometers away from his house. However, patient now complains of shortness of breath even while going to the washroom. Since 7 days, patient had to stop his work because of the shortness of breath. Patient also says shortness of breath relieves on lying to the right side and aggravates on lying to the left side. There was no history suggestive of PND or orthopnea. There was no history of palpitation or syncope. Patient also gives the history of undocumented, unintentional.
Yeah, we'll just discuss the symptoms. Just come
okay,
back.
Sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah, this one. So the fever is the first symptom that you're getting up here. And so based on your symptoms, we are probably dealing with the respiratory system, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's what we are thinking of. So you have a fever in a patient. What sort of fever do you think this is?
Sir, it was a low-grade fever, more in the evening. So,
okay. So low-grade fever, so, more in the evening. So,
more
since it is not associated with chills and rigors, that's when they classify it as low-grade.
Low-grade, sir.
You have a chills and rigors, possibly would have said a high-grade fever. That's there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You say there is an evening rise in temperature. Yes. What does that infer to you? An evening rise of temperature.
Sir, any chronic inflammatory conditions like TB and all can lead to the evening rise of temperature because corticosteroid. Sir,
why
because
is the evening temperature is more.
Sir, because of the circadian rhythm, there will be low level of steroid, corticosteroids in the body in the evening time.
Okay.
That leads to the more of pyrogens and in the body, and patient feels fever in the evening time more.
Okay. So again, remember that there's a normal circadian rhythm of the fever itself, isn't it? Temperature normal fluctuation. What happens when there is a normal fever? Now, what's the normal temperature in the 6 a.m.?
Sir, 1 degree Celsius will be more compared to the
early morning. Around 0.5 degrees. So, 37.2 in the morning, it will be around 0.3 and 37.7 in the evening. So, there's a 0.5 degree rise in the temperature. Supposedly, somebody has low-grade fever. What happens in the evening? There is a 0.5 degree addition to that, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that's why they feel more feverish in the evening.
Evening.
So almost all low-grade fevers have a evening rise. So it's more commonly seen in tuberculosis, but it can occur with any low-grade fever.
Yes, sir.
Low-grade fever, supposedly the temperature is 37.2 is a normal.
Yes, sir.
And the temperature has rise to 37.3 or 37.4. The patient may not feel the fever because the set point, what is there, is around 37.6 or something. Maybe. But what happens in the evening? To that 37.4, you have an addition of
0.5.
That's where it will cross the, if you say 37.6, the cutoff, we say, it will add 0.5. No? So it will cross it. So they will feel more feverish in the evening. So if you have low grade fever with the evening, the patient has fever throughout the day. Possibly the evening rise is secondary to the normal circadian rhythm.
Normal circadian.
The reason for that is since the corticosteroid levels are lower,
low.
pyrosine activity would be more, that would be coming. So here we have a low grade fever in a patient who's been going for 1 month duration. So it's almost going into like a chronic fever, isn't it? It's not a
chronic. Yes, yes.
Chronic fever. It's there. So the fever used to relieve on taking medications. That's what you said. So once the patient is taking the medications, maybe we may not be able to classify the type of fever.
Type. Okay.
But what are the common types of fevers you're aware of?
Sir, continuous, intermittent, intermittent, then specific pattern like OTD and fever are...
Okay, they're all subtypes of intermittent.
Intermittent fever.
What's the third type? Continuous, intermittent and?
Relapsing.
Remittent, isn't it?
Remittent.
So these are the three patterns of fevers that you would have. Provided the patient does not take any medications, you would generally get these patterns.
Okay.
So patterns of fever, whenever is a patient has been having a long-standing fever, we should try to elicit the patterns of fever. Why? Why will it help us? Does it help us, patterns of fevers?
Yes, sir, etiologically certain diseases.
Can you tell me some etiologically?
Sir, in malaria and all,
quotidian
fever or paroxysm, intermittent. Sir. Then in Hodgkin's.
Of malaria, you can get the various patterns.
Yes, sir. In
fever.
Sir, every third day patient will be having that
quotidian, not quarter. Quotidian is once in third day. Quotidian is
quotidian
fever is daily spike, isn't it? Every day spike is called as quotidian. And tertian is once in 48 hours. Tertian is once in 48 hours. And quotidian is once in 72 hours. So if a patient has fever daily, that is quotidian fever.
Okay.
And what's the classical pattern of vivax and falciparum? What pattern do you get of the three types? Quotidian, tertian, or quotidian?
Sir, quotidian only, sir.
Malaria. Vivax and falciparum.
Sir, falciparum, it's quotidian.
No.
I'm not sure.
It's most common, isn't it? It is tertian fever, isn't it? Well, vivax as well as falciparum produce tertian fever. They generally produce tertian fever. If supposedly somebody has quotidian fever and malaria, what is your inference?
Quotidian fever and malaria.
Both of them have their life cycles coming once in 48 hours, the RBCs rupture. That's why they get it. If supposedly they have a quotidian fever, that means it's a mixed infection. Vivax and falciparum together.
Okay, sir.
Quotidian, as you said, once in 72 hours is classically for which malaria?
Malaria.
Plasmodium malaria. We do not find it in India. Ovale will behave like vivax only. Ovale will behave like vivax. Any other types of malaria you have in India? It's not come into India yet. Any other than these four?
Yes, sir.
Which is the other form of? Yes, it is Plasmodium novelsi, isn't it?
Novelsi.
That's a new pathogen that's come up with malaria. So, if you have these patterns, then you know it's one of these types of malarias. Okay.
Okay.
Fine. What do you mean by bi-quotidian fever? We said quotidian is one spike in a day. What is bi-quotidian fever? What do you mean by bi-quotidian or double quotidian? What does it mean?
Two spikes in a day.
Correct. Two spikes in a day. So again, a very characteristic pattern it is. Which conditions do you get it? Especially in the north, you have this disease. Yes. In south, you don't find this. Yes, you get it in
visceral
leishmaniasis. Correct. Visceral leishmaniasis is a very important cause of tertian fever. What belt do you get leishmaniasis commonly in?
Sir, Bihar and...
Bihar, Orissa, that belt. So if somebody is hailing from that belt and has fever going on for a long time, it could be Kalazar. So it could be visceral leishmaniasis. What are the other causes of bi-quotidian fever or double quotidian fever?
Sir, any cortical vein thrombosis?
Cortical vein thrombosis, correct. It causes very high spiking. It generally causes a remitting fever. It doesn't cause intermittent. Okay. Adult onset Still's disease. I think in the chat somebody has written Still's disease. Yes. Very important. What is the classical pattern? Can you give me how the patients with Still's disease will present?
Sir, recurrent or generalized lymphadenopathy, recurrent ulnar ulcer and arthralgia.
Yes.
And high spiking fever, sir.
Usually young, very young patients. Very young patients. They can have a rash. If they are supposedly somebody is fair, then you can make out the color of the rash. What's the color of the rash?
Red.
What is the color described as?
I'm not sure, sir.
Something like a salmon color rash.
Salmon color. Okay, sir.
And what's the laboratory test which is very pathognomonically in adult onset Still's disease? Which test will be very much elevated? Which inflammatory
ferritin.
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 Very high ferritin. And in contrast, you could have a ESR which is falling. ESR which was a little higher comes down falling. So it's a very common disease which is more frequently we see now. Adult onset Still's disease. So young patient coming with high spiking fevers, double quotidian fevers you can get. Okay. Which is the third cause of bicotodian fever? Visceral leishmaniasis, adult onset Still's disease, and endocarditis due to which one? Not all endocarditis. One organism which
Natival endocarditis.
Meningococcal endocarditis. Neisseria. So Neisserial endocarditis is known to produce this double quotidian fever.
Okay.
So if the patient has this intermittent fever, then you know the diseases could be malaria, could be visceral leishmaniasis, as you said, could be some of the connective tissue disorder. What are the other causes where you can have intermittent fever? Common causes? Any other infections? Urinary tract.
HIV.
UTI. Very, very characteristic. Mm-hmm. And one more very common infection which you have intermittent fever?
Enteric fever.
Enteric is generally not intermittent. Enteric is a continuous race.
Okay.
All viral fevers are generally continuous fevers. All viral fevers, generally continuous fevers. Okay. Dengue, you do get a high spiking fevers. It does just not touch the baseline that much. Okay.
Okay.
Streptococcal tonsillitis. Always remember, very common streptococcal tonsillitis is one condition where you can get this. Intermittent fever. So remember urinary tract infection, streptococcal tonsillitis, malaria, Kala-Azar, endocarditis, all these conditions you get a intermittent fever. Okay. Most of the other conditions either have a continuous or a remittent fever.
Right.
Conditions where you have remittent. What do you mean by remittent?
Sir, fever will touch the baseline and then again.
That is intermittent. No? Touching the baseline is intermittent. Remittent is? It does not touch the baseline and the fluctuations are more than a degree, more than 1.5 degrees, it never touches the baseline. Which conditions? High spiking fever like that.
Sir, high spiking fever like cortical vein thrombosis.
Cortical vein thrombosis, very important. Cortical vein thrombosis is one thing that is very characteristic. You get something called as a picket fence fever.
Picket fence fever.
Yes. Very, very high spiking fever. You can get that in cortical vein thrombosis. So non-infectious causes can be thought of. So whenever we have a fever as a presenting feature, which has been going on for 1 month, we will have to carefully look into that and see what it is. So we will have to take the history of what pattern is it and is it relieved by medications? You said that.
Okay.
Whether it is having a pattern. So supposedly, if it is a Hodgkin's disease, what would be the pattern of fever?
Sir, 14 days fever will be there and...
Yeah, so they have something called as a periodic fever.
Periodic, yes sir.
Name given for that? It's called as Phelps-Epstein fever, isn't it?
Phelps-Epstein fever.
They'll have high spiking fever for a few days and after that they will have afebrile state and again it comes back as such. So possibly something like that. So something is going on for a longer time than it is. When do you consider it as pyrexia of unknown origin?
Sir, if patient is having 38.3 degree Celsius on several occasion, more
Okay.
than 3 weeks, sir, duration more than 3 weeks, and uncertain etiology even after 1 week of inpatient hospital admission or more than two outpatient evaluation.
Okay, so this was a traditional definition of pyrexia of unknown origin, where
Sir.
they say that we have to wait for 3 weeks, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Has it been updated of late?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Do we
Sir,
have to
it's
wait for 3 weeks?
sir, no, sir, not two, like 1 week of inpatient admission.
One
Sorry,
week, correct, as you said, 1 week of intelligent inpatient investigation. We have to, if supposedly we have evaluated thoroughly and then ruled out common things, still we could have it at 1 week only. We can call it as pyrexia of unknown origin. Okay. So here this patient has not been evaluated possibly, but he is having a low-grade fever. That's why he's not been evaluated. Otherwise, he would have got evaluated if it was a high-grade fever. So that's the first symptom that we have. So we know this process is going on for a longer time.
One
It could be an infection. It could
or
be non-infectious also.
non-infectious cause.
Non-infectious. So can you tell me some non-infectious causes of fever?
Sir, malignancy and any
Malignancy, correct.
autoimmune disorders like
Autoimmune disorders, correct.
yes, sir, vasculitis,
Yes, correct.
rheumatoid arthritis, sir, then art, sir,
Autoimmune,
like
inflammatory diseases, which you said, correct.
autoimmune.
Malignancy, you told. Drugs, isn't it? Drugs.
Drug fever, yes,
Very common causes of drugs. So, a lot of drugs produce fever. And then, as we
sir.
discussed about thrombosis, isn't it? People have thrombosis, either a DVT or a CVT, anywhere. Thrombosis or a hemorrhage itself can produce fever. That could be. You have some rarer causes that could be there. There could be. So that could be the causes of a fever which has been going on. Okay. Next, going on to the next symptom that we have here is history of cough. Yes.
Cough since 1 month, sir, which
Yes.
was insidious in onset, not associated with any expectoration or chest pain. He
This is
says,
the not expectoration. So it's a dry cough. This patient
dry
is having
cough, sir.
dry cough.
Patient is having dry cough.
So what is your inference of this? This is a cough which has been
Sir,
going on for 1 month, but it is dry.
1 month, yes, sir.
So what is your inference regarding the cough?
Sir, it's a subacute duration, sir, and it
Okay.
is not associated with any suppurative disorders like lung parenchyma is not
When
involved.
will you say it is chronic cough?
Sir,
You want to say it
it
is
is more than 8 weeks.
More than
It's
8 weeks.
8 weeks.
Is chronic cough.
Chronic, yes, sir.
So
Up
less
to
than
3 weeks is
4 to 4 months.
acute. 3 to 8
Four
is
to six.
subacute.
So this is something like a subacute cough. This is
Subacute cough.
dry. So
Yes, sir.
what is the site of lesion for this cough according to you?
Sir, like in this condition or in generally the site of cough you're asking, sir?
This patient, he had, does not have expectoration, isn't it?
Sir, it's not having lung parenchyma is not involved most
Lung
likely.
parenchyma may not be involved. What else may not be involved?
And sir, terminal bronchioles also not involved because
The
that causes
airways itself.
expectoration. Yes,
Airways
sir.
also will have secretion. So
Yes, sir.
parenchyma, the airways both produce productive sputum, correct?
Product, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So the entire tree plus the parenchyma, lung parenchyma
Parenchyma.
would produce productive sputum. So those are not involved. So it could be
Yes,
something else. So what are the other sites where the patient can have cough?
sir, in upper airway, like
Correct.
pharynx, larynx,
Correct. Correct. Yes.
then it can be involvement of the pleura, it can be
Pleura,
involvement of
correct.
the sir, cough receptors also present in pericardium, esophagus, gastric,
More
and
importantly, in the lung,
sir, interstitium can
interstitial,
also,
correct.
yes, sir.
Interstitial, correct. So
Yes,
interstitial, as well as you said, pleura, as you said,
sir.
diaphragm, upper
Diaphragm.
airway, correct. All of these can produce cough that is there,
Yes,
but
sir.
does not have expectoration,
Yes,
that much
yes.
expectoration. So what's the normal amount of sputum that would come per day?
10 to 15 ml per day, it's normal, sir.
10 to 15 ml per day is the
Is
normal.
normal.
So that would be there. So, but this patient was getting relieved with taking cough syrup. What does it mean?
Sir, basically he's getting cough because of the some nerve irritation only, sir, and because of the cough syrup
Cough
or
syrup, what are the cough syrups containing usually now? Don't get stuff.
norskafen,
We don't get stuff.
bromhexin
No, we don't get that
or
often now. Codeine and all is
norskafen.
not available now, no? That often. suppress the nerves. So most of the cough syrups would be generally either a expectorant or there is a bronchodilator. Yeah, but then if he's taking a specific cough syrup, which is like a codeine or something, or your dextromethorphan or something, then possibly you can say that it is the suppressing of the thing. Okay, so otherwise, cough without expectoration getting relieved with the cough syrup is little difficult to. I mean, expectoration might decrease.
Sir,
take a bronchodilator.
Sir, not completely, sir, but
maybe
little bit improvement.
Maybe something symptomatic, some relief is there for him. Okay.
Yeah.
What's the importance of this diurnal and positional variation of cough?
Positional variation of cough. Sir, diurnal and positional in asthma and all, patient will be having cough in the early morning daytime.
Correct.
Or so if patient is having failure, cardiac symptoms will be having in the night time.
Correct.
And positional variation basically in suppurative lung disorder in lung abscess or bronchiectasis, that position dependent
okay,
patient
so
will be having expectation.
So you can have a positional variation. Okay. Okay. What are the other conditions where you can get nocturnal cough? Other causes of nocturnal
cough? Post nasal dripping, GERD, then cardiac asthma.
GERD, very important. GERD is one thing.
Yes.
Always importantly remember. Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
Then post nasal dripping, then. Cardiac asthma, sir, even failure can present like a evening cough and all. And eosinophilic pneumonitis, hypersensitive pneumonitis. Tropic and eosinophilia can
eosinophilic lung disorders can also produce. Again, they are more associated with the cough as a predominant symptom. Eosinophilic disorders that you have. And I think you can have a cough variant asthma also, where cough could be a predominant symptom which could be coming rather than this one. No history of blood after coughing, so hemoptysis is not there.
Is not there, sir. And it's not associated with any smoke.
Commonest cause of hemoptysis that you would get encountered?
Chronic bronchitis is the. Sir, any
bronchitis?
Bronchitis, yes. Bronchitis,
sir. Yes, correct. Correct.
Like other causes, like infectivity allergy, like TB, can cause the hemoptysis. Then malignancy in elderly male smoking history, malignancy you should think of, sir. Then any cardiac causes like mitral stenosis can lead to the hemoptysis.
Okay.
Then
pneumonia
mold TB, like pneumonia, sir.
Yeah. Pneumonia itself can cause bronchitis,
Yes, sir.
Fibrosis, which is there under Remember, the most common cause for the hemoptysis is bronchitis. Is the common cause.
Yes.
So here we have a patient who has 1 month history of fever and 1 month history of dry cough.
Dry cough, sir.
So possibly respiratory is involved because the cough is persistent. That much we can make out.
Yes, sir.
Could it be tuberculosis?
Possible, sir. But possible, sir. Tubercular cough and cough and fever possible, sir. Tuberculosis.
Then what sort of tuberculosis will produce? No,
extra pulmonary. Patient is sir. Pleuritic, extra pleural involvement like pleural effusion.
Pleural tuberculosis or a lymph node.
Lymph node. Irritation.
Lymph node.
Yes, sir.
Lymph node which is producing an irritation there. That can produce.
Yes. Yes,
otherwise,
sir.
Tuberculosis per se should have cough with.
Expectoration
may not be large amount of expectoration. We'll have some amount of expectoration with hemoptysis. That would have been a main. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Let's go to the next slide. Suppose in a given patient, this is what it is. Right side spinoacromial distance is 15 centimeters. Left side is 17 centimeters. What is your inference? Which side is abnormal?
Sir, actually.
Right or left?
It's left, right side is 17 centimeter, left is 15
okay, fine. Okay, we'll take it like that only. Okay, right side is 7. What you have written, we'll take it.
Yes.
Right side is 15, left side is 17. In a supposedly some patient.
Yes, sir.
Which side is abnormal?
Sir, in this case, left side is abnormal, sir.
Based on what you have written, it is left side
is
abnormal.
Yes, sir.
Why is the spinoacromial distance increased?
Because of the collapse in that side causes the
so what
displacement.
So what? Why is the acromial displaced? There is a shoulder droop, isn't it?
Shoulder drooping, yes, sir.
There is a drooping of the shoulder happening on that side.
Yes, sir.
So when there is a shoulder droop, obviously the acromion will go down.
Okay.
So that is why the distance will increase on the side.
Yes, sir.
So spinoacromial distance increases in fibrosis and collapse.
Yes, sir.
Whereas spinoscapular distance decreases.
Yes, sir.
In fibrosis and collapse. It's not
same,
okay? Spinoscapular and spinoacromial distance is not the same. Spinoacromial distance is for the upper lobe. And it's basically, it increases in fibrosis and collapse because of the shoulder droop.
Yes, sir.
The spinoscapular distance is basically decreased on the side of fibrosis and increased on the side of effusion.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So the measurements, you have to be careful. There's something wrong happened in the measurement. Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, vocal parameters, it's reduced in the all the areas on the right side, except in the infraaxillary and infrascapular, where it is absent, sir. And left side, it's normal, sir.
Okay. So vocal, this is the second most important thing that you have to do in respiratory system. One is your measurement and expansion. Second one is the vocal resonance, not the vocal parameters. Yes, you're supposed to do the vocal resonance. Tell the same findings for parameters. So vocal resonance.
Okay.
So here you're saying it is decreased. So what are the conditions where vocal parameters or vocal resonance is decreased?
Vocal parameters are decreased in the collapse and fibrosis, sir. And even in the effusion also it is decreased, or it can be absent.
So effusion, pneumothorax, collapse, fibrosis, all these conditions, it is decreased. It is only increased in
consolidation, sir.
Consolidation or a large cavity, if it is there, only consolidation it is increased. So we are saying decreased. So we know the disease could be either effusion or could be pneumothorax, or it could be fibrosis or collapse. So that's our diagnosis as of now.
Yes, sir. So
this patient has some evidence of decreased, I mean, some evidence of either a pleural effusion or something, but the trachea and mediastinum has not been shifted.
Yes, sir.
And your movement, the hemithorax is remaining. The hemithorax is not decreased or increased. So there is some combination thing that is happening in this patient. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So there are some features of consolidation. There are some features of possibly a pleural effusion or collapse in your patient.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, percussion, left side it's resonant, sir. Right side it's impaired in all the area, and dullness felt in the infraaxillary and infrascapular area, sir.
Okay. What sort of dullness?
Stony dullness, sir.
Stony dullness. Why do you say it's stony dullness? How do you qualify it as stony dullness?
Sir, we'll get that fleximeter get hard or resistant offered when we are percussing. That is stony dullness.
You will get a resistance that is there. So you will also feel the pain when you percuss that area. So that is the stony dullness that's there. Specific for pleural effusion.
Pleural effusion.
Is there, that means the pleural effusion is quite sure that's there.
Yes, sir.
And above that, you're saying it's impaired.
Yes, sir.
So what does that indicate?
There is reduced air entry in the right side, or it can be because of the collapse or fibrosis, sir.
Okay, you're saying it's collapse or fibrosis. Okay. So collapse or fibrosis can produce impaired note. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that could be the thing. Okay, you have written that the left mammary area is resonant.
Sir?
Is the left mammary area normally resonant?
Sir, heart. No, sir. But
left
here,
mammary area, what is located?
Sir, heart. And base of the heart, sir.
Heart, isn't it? So cardiac dullness should be there, no?
Sir, sir. But compensatory hypertrophy.
Don't write it as
that. Yes, sir. Okay.
Compensatory hypertrophy. That's abnormal. Compensatory means what should have happened to the expansion on that side? It should have increased. And this is in 1 month disease. So you don't get a compensatory change that is happening here. So if you're saying that there is resonance in the mammary area, that means this patient has COPD emphysema.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Okay.
You should be careful. Left mammary area there is a cardiac dullness there.
Okay,
so write it as cardiac dullness is present in left mammary area. You don't have to write it as resonant.
Okay,
momentary rate is resonant. That means the diagnosis is emphysema.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, shifting dullness was absent, sir. Liver dullness felt in the fifth intercostal space in the on the right side in the midclavicular line. Liver span was 14 centimeter.
How could you make out the liver dullness in this patient?
Sir?
The infraaxillary area?
And infraaxillary and infrascapular area are dull, sir.
Dull, na?
Yes, sir. But
memory area was impaired.
Yes, huh? Yes, sir, impaired only.
Okay, so maybe since you're saying it is impaired, then maybe you can get a liver dullness.
Yes, sir.
But otherwise, if there is a dullness in that area, you can't get a separate liver dullness.
Okay, sir.
Since you said it's impaired, it's okay. Then maybe we can say it is liver dullness. Okay.
Sir, and tidal percussion was negative, sir.
Okay, what is tidal percussion?
Sir, to know whether the pathology is supra-diaphragmatic or infra-diaphragmatic, if it is a supra-diaphragmatic, that after deep inspiration, that percussion resonant won't change, sir. If it is a infra-diaphragmatic, that during the deep inspiration, the dullness will be, resonant will be pushed to the one or two intercostal space below.
So whenever you get a dullness in the right mammary area,
yes, sir.
Okay, especially in the fourth or fifth intercostal space.
Yes, sir.
If you get it up there, above that level, there is no use of doing liver tidal percussion.
Okay,
but sir, if you get a dullness in the left right-sided fifth space,
yes, sir.
So where you may think it could be a diaphragm, it could not be a diaphragm, or it could be a lung dullness. So yes, to differentiate that dullness, whether it is due to causes above the diaphragm or below the diaphragm, you do tidal percussion.
Okay,
how sir. Do you do the tidal percussion?
First we start percussing from above upwards. When you get the dullness, liver dullness, we'll ask the patient to take deep inspiration, sir. And again start
deep
percussing.
Inspiration and?
Hold the breath.
Hold the breath, isn't it? Hold the breath. And then you percuss the?
Below, downwards.
Okay.
If normally? Normally that dullness will be to the one or two spaces, sir.
Okay. So the dullness would move down. The diaphragm would move down by one to two spaces. That's normal. If it does not, then the dullness remains there. That means the cause of dullness is?
Effusion or?
It could be
subpulmonic
effusion.
Yes.
So basically the tidal percussion is a measure of diaphragmatic excursion. So as the diaphragm is moving up and down, that's would be there. The moment you say tidal percussion is negative, what does that mean?
Something pathology is above the diaphragm.
Okay, so during tidal percussion, the dullness remained. That's what it means. Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, auscultation, there was no added sound heard. Sir, and all the breath sounds are reduced intensity on the right side in all the area, and it was absent in the infraaxillary and infrascapular area, sir. And normal
was absent breath sounds, but otherwise it was diminished in the entire right side.
Entire right side, it was diminished.
Okay.
Yes, sir. And it was normal on the left side. There was no other added sound, sir.
Okay, so the breath sounds were diminished in intensity.
Yes, sir.
So, fine. Okay.
Sir, vocal resonance, it's reduced in all the areas, sir, and it was absent in the right infraaxillary and infrascapular area. Left side, it was normal, sir.
Okay.
And sir, succussion plascandal, should we do
when
it, sir?
When
you are suspecting hydropneumothorax, like I'm not suspecting hydropneumothorax, we're not supposed to say no, sir, in this case sheet.
Okay. No, when there's only a straight line dullness, if you get only then you do suspect a hydropneumothorax. That is when you suspect do a succussion splash.
Okay,
otherwise,
sir,
you don't do it.
Okay, sir.
Since you've got what are the signs of hydropneumothorax? Classical signs of hydropneumothorax?
Sir, shifting dullness and
shifting dullness.
Horizontal level of
straight line dullness.
And succussion splash.
Succussion splash.
And
one more. All the S's, they say. Sound of coin, isn't it? The coin test.
Coin test, okay, sir.
And the last one, what bronchial breathing you can get in a hydropneumothorax?
Amphoric.
Amphoric, correct. So these are the five things that a patient with hydropneumothorax would have. So straight line dullness, shifting dullness, percussion splash, sound of coin, and they may have an amphoric bronchial breathing. Okay. So based on this, okay, your other systems are normal, isn't it? Okay. So based on your findings, what is your final diagnosis?
Sir, right-sided partial collapse of the right side lung with right-sided pleural effusion. Etiology, query malignancy or tuberculosis. Not in respiratory failure, not in carpal pulmonary.
Not in respiratory failure, not in carpal. Okay. Why do you say it's a partial collapse?
Sir, because it's not entirely absent here, sir. And it's partially normal vesicle.
What do you mean by partial collapse?
I don't know, sir. Uh, like
What do you mean by complete collapse? What do you mean by partial collapse?
Sir, complete collapse means all the lobes are collapsed.
No. Partial collapse means there is a bronchus which is not completely obliterated.
Okay. There is
a patency that is maintained. There is a patency that is maintained. So the area is, some amount of area is, air is gone in, some of them is not. Okay. So that is what we mean by partial collapse.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's just take, left collapse. What are the findings in your patient which is suggestive of a collapse?
Sir, inspection, there is a reduced movement, sir, on the right
reduced
side.
Reduced movement, correct.
And percussion, it's impaired note.
Impaired note, okay.
And reduced movement, there is
reduced expansion, reduced movement, reduced expansion, and
auscultation, reduced breath sound, sir.
Reduced breath sound is there, okay. Intensity. Collapse, you normally have absent breath sounds.
Okay, sir.
Collapse, you should normally have absent breath sounds with no adventitious sounds.
Okay,
so your patient did not have any adventitious.
Any added sound. Added sound, no.
So that would be a more feature of a collapse rather than fibrosis. Okay. So this patient has some features of it. Okay. Now, which part of the lung has collapsed according to you?
Sir, pan lobar collapse. All the whole right side whole lung is collapsed, sir.
Why? Why do you say so? Trachea is central, no?
Sir,
trachea is central. In your patient, sir, trachea is central.
That can be explained by the effusion, or if it is a fixed mediastinum, like any malignancy that compressing the trachea.
No, that's what, when you're saying, sir, when you're saying a partial, whatever, when you're saying, if supposedly I want to consider a collapse, but the trachea is central.
Yes, sir.
So which lobes have got collapsed?
Sir, lower lobe collapse. Usually upper lobe collapse.
Yeah, the lower lobe or a middle lobe. Lower lobe, or a middle lobe should have got collapsed.
Yes, sir.
So what would be the signs of a lower lobe or middle lobe collapse, which you would have got in your patient?
Sir,
what would have happened to the diaphragm?
Diaphragm will be pushed upward.
Diaphragm would have been pushed up, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
You got impaired note or dull note at an earlier, higher level, isn't it, in your patient?
Yes, sir.
You got that in a higher level, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So, why can't that be part of collapse? I say this patient has a right-sided middle and lower lobe collapse rather than upper lobe? Upper lobe is paired.
Sir, supraclavicular hollowing was present, sir, here.
Okay. Supraclavicular hollowing is only one feature which is saying that the upper lobe is involved. Otherwise, trachea being central and only the lower part being dull, impaired note, etc. For me, the diagnosis is a right-sided middle and lower lobe collapse. That is why my diagnosis. So, if I say this is a middle and lower lobe collapse, what is the cause?
Sir, malignancy or any lymph node obstruct compressing the...
So always remember, middle and lower lobe getting collapsed together is always due to lymph node obstruction. The middle lobe bronchus as well as the lower lobe bronchus are at proximity there. And if you have a lymph node that is there, extrinsic compression, if it was a bronchial obstruction, it would have been one lobe, either middle or lower.
Yes, sir.
But if both these lower lobes, middle and lower lobe together getting, that is always an extrinsic compression due to a lymph node. That is what we can think of. So the lymph node could be due to malignancy. The lymph node could be due to tuberculosis. You have an entity called as epituberculosis. Have you heard of an entity called as epituberculosis?
No, sir.
Epituberculosis is nothing but tuberculous hilar lymph
apex.
Node.
Hilar, okay.
And that is causing a compression or a collapse of the... So, right-sided, middle and lower lobe collapse.
Yes, sir.
Now, why do you say pleural effusion is there in this patient?
Sir, because dull note and absent breath sounds there in the infant.
Absent breath sound is explained by collapse.
Sir.
What feature of pleural effusion this patient has?
Dull, stony dullness, sir, on percussion.
That is the only thing that you're saying, stony dull.
Yes, sir.
So again, that's a very subjective thing. You cannot demonstrate to me what is stony dull, correct?
Yes, sir.
You feel is what you feel.
Yes, sir.
I can't, it cannot be same which you say.
Okay,
so
sir.
Just because if there is a pleural effusion, supposedly there's a pleural effusion, what should have been the features? The hemithorax should have been increased in size.
Increased, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Or it should have been maintained as normal as your patient has.
Yes, sir.
Whatever, so for some reason your patient's hemithorax has remained normal.
Yes, sir.
Despite of movements being decreased, the hemithorax is normal. Despite of dullness, hemithorax is normal. That means there are two diseases that are coexisting possibly in your patient.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So okay. only that stony dullness is a feature that is fitting into pleural effusion mm-hmm. that is there. Otherwise, my diagnosis would be a right-sided middle and lower lobe collapse. Okay. Secondary to either malignancy or tuberculosis. That is a feature that you would think of.
Okay, sir.
Okay. What would have been the feature if the... What other feature would have been there if it was have been a collapse? What else could have been there? If it's a middle and lower lobe, I'm saying.
Yes,
what
sir.
Other features would have helped you in putting the diagnosis to middle and lower lobe?
Sir, absent breath sounds are...
Absent breath sounds is there in the patient. Hmm. So that's there. What other feature? If the lower part of the lung or the lower...
Apex
would have been shifted. Medially. Now here you could not get the apex by inspection, palpation.
Yes, sir.
Auscultation wise, you could make out the apex.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Was it in normal position?
Normal position only, sir. It was in normal position only, sir.
Okay, so it was in normal position. So that's a little against the diagnosis of a lower mediastinum shift because the apex should have been shifted medially possibly. That would have helped.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so. Pleural effusion, I am not very convinced. Collapse is one thing which I would say as a diagnosis in this patient.
Okay, sir.
So he had chest pain, he had fever, that would be there. And then he had features suggestive of collapse in this patient. My diagnosis first could be malignancy. Second being tuberculosis, a big lymph node.
Yes, sir.
Lymph node, what we call it as an epituberculosis. That should have been the diagnosis. Patient not in respiratory failure or coropulmonale. Okay, that is your complete diagnosis that you would can give.
Yes, sir. Sir.
Any other?
Yes, sir. I have the X-ray of that patient, sir. This was the X-ray.
We'll discuss that later.
Okay.
Any other questions or queries at this time in the chat? Pleuritic chest pain, shortness of breath. Shortness of breath can be explained by a collapse. So remember, a patient becomes breathless when more than one lobe of the lung is involved. Now here, based on whatever the findings, I told that there are two lobes of the lung that is involved. That is middle and lower lobe. So could be significant. So the shortness of breath can be explained. Now pleuritic chest pain, you will have to explain it by either malignancy. Okay. Malignancy causing involvement of this one or yeah. I'm not saying pleuritic chest pain is there, but here the patient had a dull pain. Na? That was against a pleuritic dull pain. So it could be anything there. You will have to explain it in some way, either by involvement of the nerves due to malignancy or something. Landmarks for measurement of the hemithorax.
I measured at the level of nipple only, sir.
Okay, so ideally, it is to be measured at the level of nipple. That's at the fourth space. Fourth space, we measure the hemithorax. Fourth intercostal space, that's where we measure it anteriorly and posteriorly. That's what is. We can get collapse in pleural effusion. No. Okay. Why this is not that? What sort of collapse do you get in pleural effusion?
Compressive collapse. Sir.
You get compressive or what we call it as. Again, the word again is not collapse. There we use the word as atelectasis. What is the difference between atelectasis and collapse?
Sir,
is it the same?
Compression from the external side.
Atelectasis is reversible.
Yes, sir.
Collapse means it could be irreversible. Okay. So here, whenever you have pleural effusion, you should have that collapse is just there. It's a secondary feature. Collapse will not have any finding. It will be having pleural effusion only finding. Increased hemithorax. Shift of mediastinum to opposite side. All those features should have been there. So this relaxation atelectasis, which you get in case of a pleural effusion, is not considered as a collapse at all. Collapse is secondary there. Okay. Significance of spinoscapular distance. Again, in pleural effusion and pneumothorax, it is increased. In fibrosis and collapse, it's decreased. Dyspnea improved after a few days. Can collapse have similar history? Here, the dyspnea came after a few days. Isn't it? It's not improved. Pain improved, but the dyspnea persisted. So collapse can have a similar history. Yeah, collapse can have. Collapse based on the amount of lung which is collapsed, they can have that history. Passive smoking importance is same as active smoking. Symptoms localizing to parenchymal lung disease. Sputum production. That's the most important. Sputum production and hemoptysis, if at all there is. That would be very specific for the lung parenchyma based on the amount of sputum. Usually lung parenchymal disease has moderate to large amount of sputum that is there. Large amount of sputum that is there, which may not be there in a non-parenchymal lung disease. Tracheal tug and descent importance in respiratory system. Again, tracheal tug is classically described for what condition?
Aortic aneurysm.
Aortic aneurysm. Aortic aneurysm, because the aortic arch will be there and with each heartbeat it will go dug up and down. That's the Oliver song. But in interstitial lung disease, ILD, severe fibrosis, what happens to the trachea?
It's pulled down.
It is pulled down. With each respiration, it is pulled down. So that is the Oliver's sign or the inspirator, so respiratory tracheal tug, which is seen in ILD. The other important thing about the trachea is your COPD patient. What happens to the COPD patients? What will happen to trachea?
Same.
Descent. You'll have a descent of trachea. Pulled you can down. Measure that, and you can calculate something called as a cricosternal distance, isn't it? Cricosternal distance. What will happen in COPD? The cricosternal distance from the sternum to the cricoid cartilage?
It decreases.
It decreases, isn't it? Decreases. That's the features. Symptoms of pleural disease basically is dry cough, dyspnea, and pleuritic chest pain. Okay. I think those were the questions. Any other questions on YouTube? No, no. Fine. I think we'll go on to the X-ray.
Yes, sir. This was the X-ray we have done, got on first day, sir.
Okay. So this is the X-ray?
On the first day. Yes, sir.
Can you read the X-ray for me?
Sir, X-ray, PA, PA view. Exposure is normal, sir. Trachea is in the central. And, sir, homogeneous opacity present in the left lower zone. Right lower zone. With, sir, CP angle is blunted, sir. And there is a limb.
What about the trachea?
Sir, trachea is in the
central.
Central only, sir. Slightly deviated.
Right. What about the cardia?
Sir, cardia slightly pushed.
Slightly also pulled. You can see that. You can see that.
Sir.
And you said the costophrenic angle is blunted for me.
Sir, on right side.
Cardiophrenic angle, is it seen or no? Is the cardiac silhouette seen? Right heart border seen?
Yes, sir.
Seen, na? So cardiophrenic angle is not blunted, correct?
Costophrenic angle on right side, sir. Blunted.
Now you just trace the diaphragm from the cardiophrenic angle. Start from the cardiophrenic angle. Are you able to trace diaphragm? Okay. Till there you can go. Laterally, maybe it's not so clear. Okay, tell me what's the position of the diaphragm in this X-ray?
Sir, slightly elevated on right side.
Slightly elevated, huh?
Then it's elevated, sir. And right, sir.
It is elevated, isn't it? It is elevated. So diaphragm is elevated, isn't it? And you have a homogeneous opacity in the lower zone. You're seeing that in the lower zone and coming up to the mid zone also, isn't it?
Yes,
somewhere to the mid zone, you can see that. And cardiophrenic angle is clear.
Yes, sir.
So the diaphragm is pulled up, and possibly the cardia is also pulled up to the. If you see, if you draw a midline, if you see the cardiac silhouette midline, more on to the right side, isn't it?
It is more
on to the right side. So possibly the cardiac is shifted up. There is some volume loss in the lower part. And that would be feature fitting into a collapse.
Yes, sir.
Okay. As you see the upper part of the shadow, what are you seeing there? Yeah. What are you showing as a mark? What sort of appearance you're seeing there? Down. Below that.
This one, sir.
Yeah, that one.
Sir, that
you're seeing a lobulated appearance, isn't it? You're seeing a lobulation there. One lobulation below that. That's one.
Yes, sir.
Some below.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there's one more lobulation there. There's one more lobulation below that. You can see
this
behind
one.
That.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So there is a multiple lobulated structure that is there.
Yes,
in
sir.
Possibly the hilum, correct?
Yes, sir.
At the hilar region, you have a lobulated structure that is there, which is seen. So what is likely to be? Which are the lobulated structures?
Sir, any malignant mass?
Lymph node,
crab.
Isn't it?
Sir,
lobulated structure is always a lymph node.
Okay.
So lobulated structure should always be a lymph node there. So we think that there is lobulation there. So, and you see that there is more dense in the shadow there. So, it could be a lymph node that you're seeing there in the hilum. In the hilum, you're seeing a lymph node possibly. And as we discussed, the collapse has happened of the middle and lower lobe. That is what our diagnosis came at the end of the and the examination. We thought it could be that. Okay. The upper part, if you see carefully, what are you finding in the upper part? Is there any shadows there? That part looks clear. The outside, the scapula is there in between. So that white shadow on the top is due to the scapula. So looks okay. The upper part looks okay. Not much.
Okay, sir.
So there might be some amount of effusion. I am not saying there is no effusion.
Just now I got the CT report, sir, like today evening only.
What is it showing?
This was the CT film, sir.
Okay, CT film, okay.
Sir, and sir, report says is small cell carcinoma lungs, sir, where multiple meds to the livers also.
Okay, and what about the lesion there? Just read that. Right hilar and subcarinal encasing lymph node.
Narrowing.
Bronchus, correct, na? What is
yes, sir.
Obstruction, bronchus.
Yes, sir.
Intermedius with extension infiltration. So, basic lesion was what? There is a big lesion in the hilum there. Big lesion in the hilum, which was producing a compression on the lymph node. Yes, that's sir. What we thought it could be. Come back to the X-ray. Okay. So, you had a big lesion there possibly. Now, if I want to... Okay, this that's possibly a lesion. It may be a... clinically, when you say, I'm saying on an X-ray, generally, when you see lobulation, we say lymph node. But it could be a lobulated tumor. I'm not saying it cannot be. It's a lobulated tumor also can be there. Now, what are the features on an X-ray which can tell you that this could be a malignancy?
Speculated appearance and...
speculated appearance. Okay, you say agreed. Where you have a speculated appearance, agreed. Something like a sunburst appearance. Yeah, written. Rib erosions, very important. Okay. So carefully look at the ribs which are located there. Very carefully, you have to carefully look at this region. See if there is a rib erosion or something. Then definitely malignancy would be likely, correct? Calcification. What is your take on calcification? Somebody in the chat has written calcification.
Sir, either it's an old lesion or benign lesion only. Sir.
So old lesion, calcification, agreed. What about malignancy? Does it calcify?
Sir,
malignancy. People in the chat who wrote calcification, can you tell me malignancy can calcify? Or what sort of calcification would be popcorn calcification? Is it malignant? Popcorn calcification? It's benign.
Benign, pulmonary hematoma.
Hematoma. What sort of calcification? Speckled calcification. Understand? Speckled, not regular. Spot, multiple. Is malignancy. If you have a dense calcification, one full lump like this, that is benign. Or you have an egg cell calcification. What do you mean by egg cell? Full round calcification. That is benign. So eggshell calcification, dense localized calcification, and patchy calcification, which is there, they're all benign calcification. Or your popcorn calcification, all are benign. But speckled calcification is suggestive of malignancy. Okay. So calcification would generally mean a chronic disease, but yes, you can get speckled calcification. So collapse that is there in a patient like this with rib erosions and speckled appearance, speculated appearance, such things could be there. Is there hepatomegaly in this patient based on your X-ray?
Sir, because of volume loss, only diaphragm is elevated.
Diaphragm
sir.
Is up, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Where is the colon?
Sir, this side I'm not able to mention. But hey,
I can see my colon. Where is the colon there?
In right side, sir.
Right side only. What is that back shadow bottom? What is that shadow here at the bottom? There is some air, I thought. Anyways, okay.
Sir, oh, X-ray. This one is this film photo only like that, sir.
No, that's what I'm saying. One, see the bubble shadows. The bubble shadows are there on the left here. The bubble shadows are much lower in the right side.
Okay, sir.
So what is this white shadow on the right side here under the diaphragm?
This one you're telling, sir?
This entire white shadow. That one. Yeah, what you're showing?
Sir, actually, that was the photo, sir, not the X-ray finding, sir.
Okay. Okay, fine. But you are having a white shadow, isn't it there?
Yes, sir.
Below the diaphragm, we said the diaphragm is up, correct? Somewhere here.
Yes.
Below that, you have a homogeneous shadow. You can see the shape of that going up to the epigastric region here. It's shaping of a liver, no? So there's a big liver in this patient. Why?
Hepatomegaly because of the metastasis.
He's not an alcoholic, no?
No, sir, not alcoholic, sir.
So smoker. It's possibly there is metastasis there in the liver?
Yes, sir. Mets there, sir, in liver.
It's there, huh? Okay. Clinically, there was no palpable liver, huh?
No, sir.
Sure. And such a big liver, I think should have been palpable. I don't know. Okay. Anyways.
Okay.
Scan is showing liver?
Sir?
CT is showing liver?
Sir.
There are no images of the liver. Just come back to the earlier image where there was a horizontal, vertical cut image.
Sir.
CT. Yeah, this one. Yeah. See the liver? How big it is? Very big. And you see the first cut here? See the diaphragm? See the right diaphragm is so high compared to the left, isn't it? Left is normally down, agreed. But right is down. Where is your effusion?
Slightly. Where is the effusion? They mentioned only 3.5 centimeter effusion, sir.
Obviously, it is less than that. I don't know. Your stony dullness, I think, was the liver which you were percussing. At the back, the liver dullness, na? Collapse is there, isn't it? So the liver has come up. So possibly your 14 centimeter might be much bigger. Your 14 centimeter liver scan you told might be much bigger there. Okay. So there's no effusion at all in your patient.
Okay. Sir.
And it's basically a collapse that is there. Okay. And the upper lobe is spared. Upper lobe is spared. It's the lower lobe and the middle lobe that is collapsed.
Okay.
And possibly there is, that's the diagnosis. I think that's what I do agree. This patient had findings which were a little, not very fitting into everything.
Yes, sir.
But yeah, we made a diagnosis why this patient had a dry cough. Possibly there is no bronchial
irritation.
Fever, part of the disease, possible.
Yes, sir.
Dyspnea, because the, and you said dyspnea on exertion.
Pan-lobar, sir. Pan-lobar
involvement. Dyspnea on exertion.
Yes, sir.
Dyspnea on exertion was against our pleural disease,
correct? Yes, sir.
That's what we discussed. The patient cannot have dyspnea and exertion because we thought it was pleural disease.
Yes,
we were a little biased at the end of the history that it is plural.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? So, actual history was saying that the lungs were getting involved. Two lobes of the lungs have got involved. That's why the patient had dyspnea as a symptom as such. Okay. Mm. Okay. So, final diagnosis is a malignancy that we have and it is a big malignancy, which is metastasized, isn't it?
Yes,
it has metastasized to the, it has gone liver. Into the abdomen also. Have they looked into the adrenals? Is there
no, sir.
Bilateral adrenals appear normal in morphology. They've written, handwritten is there.
Okay.
Bilateral adrenals appear normal in morphology. Basically, they look for it because that is the first site of metastasis.
Hmm.
So, do you want to still rule out Addison's in this patient?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you would want to rule out just because adrenals are normal in morphology does not. You could want because that is again a common site of metastasis that you can get in these patients.
Okay.
Fine. So this is a metastatic tumor.
Yes, sir.
What sort of tumor do you think it is?
Sir, either small cell or squamous cell carcinoma.
Small cell or squamous cell, which is more likely?
Squamous cell, sir, because he's a
which
smoker.
Is more likely. Why do you say?
Sir, he's a smoker.
Why small cell will not come in smoker?
Sir, it may be there, but sir, chances are less. And patient with the small cell usually present with the paraneoplastic symptoms more than the squamous cell carcinoma.
Okay, paraneoplastic has to be there, but need not be there also. I'm not saying that. Okay.
Sir, but
centrally located mass, isn't it? It's a centrally located tumor that's there.
Sir, but both small cell and squamous cell can be present as a central location.
Peripheral would be usually adeno that would be
adenocarcinoma, sir.
Okay. So fine. So you will have to prove what type of it is. Is it important to prove what type of?
Yes, sir. Sir, treatment modality changes.
So what would be a next investigation that you'd want to do?
After CCT, I would like to do bronchoscopy guided biopsy only. Bronchoscopy guided biopsy only will be the better. or ultrasound guided, sorry, endoscopy guided biopsy.
Biopsy, yeah. You can do a CT guided
Tissue
biopsy
diagnosis.
or a
Yes, sir.
bronchoscopy. Since you have a proximal lesion, maybe you can do a bronchoscopy also. Otherwise, you can do a CT guided biopsy and then prove. What else you want to do with the biopsy sample?
Sir, do markers like
Which marker you would want to do? Anything else
synapt,
you want?
sir,
Yeah.
or sin
Any mutations you want to look for?
sir, ha, sir, Keras and Mike P53.
KRAS mic is for anything. For squamous cell or CA lung, you generally ask for a EGFR mutation status. Based on that, your monoclonal antibodies that we give would vary. Okay. Fine. So that is your final diagnosis that you would be getting. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So that is possibly things. Okay. Can you list some? Do we have time? Or
Yes, sir.
okay.
Yes,
What are
sir.
the names? Some common paraneoplastic manifestations.
Sir, SIADH and
SIADH, one of the
yes,
very
sir.
common, correct?
Small cell carcinoma and hypercalcemia,
Hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia is due to what?
parathyroid related hormone secretion in
Parathyroid hormone related
squamous cell
peptide.
carcinoma.
Yes. Okay. You can stop sharing the screen. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What are the other things?
Sir, then you can have a Cushing syndrome because of the small cell
Cushing
carcinoma.
syndrome. Remember, Cushing syndrome, not Addison's. Addison's is due to metastasis. Cushing's is due to paraneoplastic. Correct. Then the other
Limbic
important, very important.
encephalitis and Lambert-Eaton
Neurological manifest.
as a
Yes,
neurological
Lambert-Eaton.
Limbic
Lambert-Eaton
encephalitis,
myasthenia,
cerebellar
peripheral neuropathy
degeneration,
could be there. Cerebellar degeneration, correct.
degeneration.
Cerebellar degeneration, very common. You can get something like an opsoclonus myoclonus also can occur.
Yes, sir.
Proximal muscle dermatomyositis can occur.
Sir.
Get clubbing, isn't it?
Clubbing,
Clubbing,
yes, sir.
clubbing. You can get hyperglycemia. You can get hyperglycemia. You can get. So you should evaluate these patients for paraneoplastic manifestations also.
Yes, sir.
So those could be the features that could be there in these patients. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other doubts or clarifications, or any other questions that are left for me to answer, or any other? I think in this I have answered everything. Any questions from the YouTube? So basically, our diagnosis was almost correct.
Yes,
At the
sir.
end of our examination, we reached that it is not effusion, it was collapse, and it
Yes, sir.
did not involve the upper lobe, it involved the middle end, lower lobe,
Middle and lower. Okay, sir.
that's there, and possibly malignancy only we got it. That could be there. A rare possibility of epituberculosis. Again, remember, epituberculosis common in pediatrics, not in adults. Not yet in adults. So, role of CEA in lung cancer. What's the role of CEA, carcinoembryonic antigen, in lung cancer? Is it used as a marker?
Lung cancer, no, sir.
It's not specific for lung cancer. It is not specific for lung cancer. Especially pleural fluid. When you have a pleural effusion and you do a CEA, then one of the possible sites is lung CEA when it is elevated. But it could be there due to gut. CEA could be from the gut, CEA could be from the bowel, that could be there. So pleural fluid CEA and all possibly is, can be used as an indirect marker there, but nothing like a specific thing for that. Case-related topics along with investigation and treatment for respiratory system. Which book to use, Alagappan and Davidson? What should I answer to that?
I'll say, sir, insider guide.
Yeah. Both of them do not give it anyway, sir. Malignancy without hemoptysis, how common? That too, such a big hilar lesion without vascular invasion. Hemoptysis is not a rule for malignancy, okay? So this is just, as you say, the symptoms
Whatever
and
the
the
big lesion
outcome.
is there, that is outside the bronchocele, that is compressing from
Yeah,
the outside.
possibly, eventually, possibly if it erodes down, we can get hemoptysis. So not necessarily that hemoptysis is needed. If it was there, it would be suspicious. Not necessarily hemoptysis is needed. There is weight loss in this patient and he's a smoker and you have evidence of a collapse of more than one lobe. Malignancy is the top priority. And anyhow, CT has confirmed it. It's a big hilar lesion, but it's an extrinsic compression. It's not a growth from inside. It's not just a intrabronchial growth. That would have been more producing hemoptysis rather than an extrinsic growth. Extrinsic growth would produce collapse as a symptom. So not necessarily that there should be hemoptysis. Okay, what's the management of lung cancer, Raghu? What's the grossly management of? If you say, you basically divide it into small cell and...
Small cell and lung cell, non-small cell carcinoma.
Yes. Non-small cell, practically we are dealing with squamous cell carcinoma.
Yes, sir.
So then you, based on the TNM, we grade the disease into early disease and late disease, isn't it? Based on the stage, we do it based on that. So if it's early disease, if it's a localized disease, has unilateral adenopathy, other lung is normal and distance metastasis is not there, we can consider it as a localized disease and that patient can be amenable for what treatment? Localized early disease with one-sided adenopathy, other lung normal, that patient can be amenable for surgical therapy, lobectomy with radical lymph nodes, etc. can be removed there. That's the only indication for surgery that is there. Otherwise, all the rest surgery is going to be just palliative, where the tumor burden, but again, we do not do surgery for any other case, be it small cell, be it non-small cell, which is gone to the other side. So it's all medical management only. Radiation therapy is useful for squamous cell carcinoma. You can use radiation therapy. Okay. What is the medical management or the chemotherapeutic agents that we have for the treatment of small cell or non-small cell? If it is non-small cell, the treatment modalities that we have is what drug?
Sir, chemotherapy.
It's chemotherapeutic drug. What base therapy we use?
Sir, paclitaxel.
Yeah, paclitaxel or cisplatin.
Cisplatin-based therapy.
Cisplatin-based or paclitaxel-based therapy. That is the basic treatment for non-small cell carcinoma. Non-small cell.
Yes,
small cell carcinoma, you have what drugs now, presently? You can have the chemotherapies. Traditional chemotherapy is there, but you have the more antibodies. You have the newer ones that are there that is available. What are the ones that you know of? Any names?
Sir, I don't know. I'm not getting, sir. Bevacizumab.
Okay. All the MABs which are there. The old one, the good old one which was brought out was the multikinase inhibitor.
Okay, sir.
What is that multikinase inhibitor? Used for everything. Jeftinib, isn't it? That is the first one which came. Jeftinib. It came almost 7 years back. It was a multikinase inhibitor. Now we have specific ones which are there. You have the erlotinib which is there. You could have the other. There are many new ones which have come, which are there, which are specific. But multikinase inhibitor, jeftinib still is used. Again, patient survival, etc. does not make a major difference. It's an oral medication with very minimal side effects. In contrast to sorafenib, which we use for HCC, there you have a large number of side effects that come with sorafenib. But with jeftinib, the side effect profile is very, not very much. So, again, the effect is also not great with jeftinib, but that is what is used. And the new ones which you have, yeah, as they have mentioned, I think, yeah, they have mentioned erlotinib, nivolumab, and yeah, pembrolizumab, all those are available. And the traditional cisplatin-based, paclitaxel-based chemotherapy is also possible. Radiation can be done. Radiation is mandatory if there is a SVC obstruction. Supposedly, there's a compression and SVC obstruction, such conditions, we would be warranted in giving radiation for the patient. Okay. I think that's the treatment. That's the gross treatment of CLR. Any other doubts or clarifications? As he's a chronic smoker, he never had chronic bronchitis hemoptysis. Please remember the commonest cause for hemoptysis is bronchitis, whatever be the cause, okay? bronchitis, acute bronchitis is the commonest cause. Chronic bronchitis also can produce hemoptysis. But yes, hemoptysis can occur very, very many other causes also. And acute bronchitis may occur even in non-smokers. Only chronic bronchitis comes in chronic smokers. So it need not be in smokers also. And again, a patient with bronchogenic carcinoma does not have to have COPD. He may have just, females have malignancies. They do not have COPD that often, but they still have lung cancer. Okay. I'm not finding any other questions. Okay. So I think before we wind up, the two important things, please remember whenever we do the respiratory system examination, your general examination, etc., is very important. But in the respiratory system examination, please concentrate on two important things. One is the hemithorax measurement, okay, the hemithorax movements, and the vocal resonance. That is going to give you the full diagnosis. So in unilateral lung disease, I'm not talking about bilateral lung diseases, COPD, ILD, etc. are bilateral diseases. But for unilateral lung disease, fibrosis, collapse, effusion, pneumothorax, hydropneumothorax, or a pneumonia, unilateral lung disease, all your diagnosis is made by hemithorax measurement and hemithorax movement and the vocal resonance. Okay, and do not waste much time in your exam doing vocal fremitus. You do the vocal resonance, whatever finding you get in vocal resonance, the same finding has to be in vocal fremitus. So make sure you do that. The side which moves less is abnormal. And based on the size of the side, you can differentiate it. And vocal resonance will confirm it. Please remember, whenever you have pleural effusion, pneumothorax, fibrosis, and collapse, the vocal fremitus has to be decreased. So when you're comparing two sides, if you just use vocal resonance, you'll not be able to say which is bigger, which is more, or which is less. For that, you will have to do the measurement. So that is why you have to do the measurement and see which side is moving less. Only then can you tell which is abnormal. Is it possible for such a large lesion in 1 month? Yes, very much possible. But it may not be 1 month. It might have been a little more than that.
Symptomatic since 1 month.
Yeah, symptomatic since 1 month. The disease might have been growing slowly earlier also. You have to go back and ask him whether he stopped smoking because he had streaking of hemoptysis.
Okay, sir.
Maybe, I'm just saying, maybe. He might have had some streaking blood, or that's why he stopped. But tumors can grow. Tumors can grow fast. It's not necessary that the tumor has to grow slowly. If immunocompromised patient, which organism causes bronchitis? Remember, bronchitis is caused by organisms, the same organisms, being competent or immunocompromised. It could be the bacterial causes, but more often causes of bronchitis are viral, be it your respiratory syncytial virus or the influenza virus. They are the more common causes. The bacterial causes remain the same: H influenza, pneumococcus, and in COPD patients, you have Moraxella catarrhalis. That's a very important organism. It's a very, very bad organism, Moraxella catarrhalis, which is seen in COPD patients. Middle lobe in MAC? Yes, definitely. Middle lobe gets involved in MAC. Basically, it's because of the lymph node. Remember, MAC is something like tuberculosis, though it's not tuberculosis per se. Middle lobe is got compressed due to a lymph node that is there in the hilum that is classically seen in primary tuberculosis in children. So similar manifestations we get in adults when they are immunocompromised. Okay? And MAC is one of the causes of that. You get something called as a Lady Windermere syndrome, which is produced by MAC. Okay. Any other questions related to respiratory system? Any doubts in the... And always give very much importance to the general examination, because your clubbing, grade 4 clubbing, all those things would suggest a malignancy. Yes. Again, this patient did not have SVC obstruction nor the Horner syndrome, etc., because it was a lower lobe thing. If such a big lesion was there in the upper lobe, we would have had those features. Okay.
I think that's the end of question 7 on YouTube and Zoom, sir. We thank you so much for your valuable time and constantly guiding us and teaching us, sir.
Thank you.
And thank you to Dr. Raghu for a well-prepared presentation, due to which we all got to learn well.
Yeah.
Very interesting case.
Yes.
And remember, tomorrow join us at 6 o'clock for a very interesting and very important topic, both clinically and for exams. Tomorrow's topic will be at 6 p.m. of mitral stenosis by Archit sir.
Okay, we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good.